Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. Today, we're building a Ron Hock shoulder plane kit. Now, this is really exciting for me because this is something that's been on my to-do list for quite a long time. And this year, when Christmas rolled around, family was like, well, what are we going to get you? And I said, if you're only going to get me one thing, this is what I want. And they listened, but also on top of it, I was a really good boy because they gave me a few other things too. But this was probably one of the things I was most excited about. In fact, I almost ended up running down during the point when we were supposed to be having dinner with the family to get started on this. So it took some discipline, but I was able to kind of set it aside and come back to it. Now, the really neat thing about this, and you'll see more about this in the video itself, everything you need except for the glue is included in the kit. The plane itself is a lamination. It has it's solid wood. The only thing on here that is not wood is the blade itself. And of course, it's a Hock blade, so you know it's going to be extremely good. In fact, it comes sharp, so you got to be really careful with that, because if you open it up and you're just like me and you start manhandling it, there's a good chance that you're going to end up walking away with a cut. But it's going to be a wonderful cut because it's such an amazing blade. But anyways, I really don't want to get too far into it because you'll see everything about this in the video itself. But the real beauty of one of these plane kits is the fact that you can customize it. And obviously, that's what I've done here. If you are looking at the plane kit online at hocktools.com, you'll notice that it comes as a rectangle. Basically, it's just a nice big rectangle. You customize it to feel exactly how you want it in your hands. Now, my hands are kind of smallish, and I prefer to have something that when I'm pushing my plane, I like to use a lot of my palm because I feel like I can get more pressure that way to push forward. And then in this situation, I have a nice little flat, which you'll see more about this when we get to the part where I started to shape it. I like to be able to push down with the shoulder plane because when we're using a shoulder plane, this isn't the type of plane where we're doing a lot of rough work. This is for finessing. This is for fine trimming. So therefore, I really want to be able to make sure that I'm pushing it down into position and it's working the material the right way. So that's part of the reason why I chose to do it the way I ended up doing it. Like I said, I can get my hand back here and push it the way I want to. And it just, trust me, the design looks a little awkward, but it works for me. And whatever design you end up going with, you can like drill out some holes or something so you can stick your fingers through it. You could probably put in some inlays, all sorts of stuff. The beauty of it is the fact that you get to customize this working hand plane because it definitely works exactly the way you want it. One thing I will say about this particular shoulder plane compared to my Veritas shoulder plane is the Veritas has a bevel up configuration. So it's a low angle plane that really does an amazing job of taking some of the lightest end grain cuttings off of, say, a shoulder for a tenon that maybe I just want to, it's not sitting exactly the way it should, the mortise. It took me a little bit to get used to using this one because it's a bevel down configuration. But to be quite honest with you, once it's sharpened, once you've got the shape the right way so that you can control it and get the best results from it, you're going to be really, really happy with it. It definitely came together wonderful. And to be quite honest with you, I haven't had a chance to really put it through a lot of wear and tear yet, but I have had a chance to try taking some end grain shavings, and you'll see this towards the end, off of a tenon that I cut in some hard maple, and it worked out fantastic. The shavings were exactly where I want it. One more thing I'm going to say about this is, unlike the Veritas shoulder plane where I can easily dial it in for the depth that I want, of course, this is a traditional wooden hand plane, so we have the blade itself, we're going to have to tap it with a mallet and work it that way, but it doesn't take very long for you to get a feel for it, and you'll start getting the results that you're looking for. So without further delay, I'm going to quit gabbing, and let's go ahead and get right into the construction of this. Actually, one more thing. I won't stop gabbing. The whole construction took maybe like a day, if that. And that was more or less me getting it started. Once I got to the glue-up phase, I ended up kind of fell asleep in the easy chair. I'm not going to lie. So I didn't have a chance to come back down and continue working on it. But the very next day I got up, within a couple of hours, I had this basic shape. So let's take a look at the video itself, and we'll talk about some other kits on the backside.
When you receive your Hock Shoulder Plane kit, it arrives with everything you need to build it, except for the glue. You'll receive two sides, one front block, one rear block, 4/4-inch diameter dowels, one wedge, and a Hock plane iron. To get started, we first need to do a dry assembly of the sides and the blocks. This is the point where you should take a close look at the grain and the figure of the sides so you can get the best look for your shoulder plane. Start by arranging the pieces so the sides are flush to the ends of the blocks. Next, hold the pieces firmly, clamp them if necessary to do so, then grab a pencil and make a cabinet maker's triangle on one end. This will allow you to easily reassemble the plane in the same configuration later on in the construction. While holding it firmly together still, grab a couple of small clamps and clamp the pieces together so that you can free up your hands for the next part. Next, insert the iron by angling it through the throat opening. Once it's been inserted, hold the iron beveled down against the rear block and slide it gently down the ramp. The iron should almost, but not quite, be able to clear the throat opening. Adjust this if necessary, but essentially you want the blade to come just shy of being able to go right through that mouth. Now, one thing you may find is that you have to play with the rear block just a little bit to get the perfect fit. Don't be discouraged or concerned if it's no longer flush with the sides in doing so. The most important thing in the end is that the mouth has the right amount of opening for the best shavings. As you'll see in a little bit, we'll be able to make adjustments to ensure this. Now, once we're satisfied everything is where it should be, it's time to insert the 1/4-inch dowels. The dowels are actually less about reinforcing the body of the plane and more about reassuring its alignment during the assembly process. Mark along the top of one side where the holes are to be drilled. In the plans for the kit, it suggested one hole near each end and one on either side of the throat. Now, as I mentioned, the holes for the dowels aren't crucial to the structure of the plane, so you can easily get away with just using a hand drill to make the holes. But having a drill press isn't a bad way to do it either. So regardless of which tool you choose, you only need to drill through one side into the blocks and then partially into the other side. You don't want the dowels exposed all the way through. With the dowel holes drilled, it's time to remove the clamps and disassemble the dry assembled sides and blocks so that we can reassemble it again. But this time, we're going to do it with the dowels in place so that we can recheck its alignment. And it's not a bad idea to do a preliminary fit of the wedge at this point. Don't worry about tapping it in place or getting a perfect fit. This is just yet another step to help ensure the alignment of the pieces is where everything should be. Now at this point, we're ready to start the glue up. But before we do that, the kit suggests that we might want to wax both the ramps and the areas of the sides that are exposed between the ramps. To help make sure I wax these areas correctly, I draw a pencil line using the blocks as a reference, and I do this on both sides. Then, using a simple paste wax, I apply a light coat to all the suggested surfaces. This little step will help to make sure excess glue squeeze out will be easier to remove after it finishes drying. This is something that is really crucial considering the tight area that this is going to be in. Then, with the ramps and exposed throat areas of the sides all waxed, it's time for the glue up. Now, it's crucial to spread an even layer of glue on all surfaces. Take the time to occasionally double check that all the parts are properly positioned, and once they are, then insert the dowels and clamp everything up. With the glue evenly spread and the pieces all in place, it's suggested you use cauls to distribute even pressure along the sides. Now, I just happen to have some scrap blocks that I knew would easily be shaped and give me the equal distribution that I needed to ensure that the glue is going to be squeezed in all the right spots and the final glue up will be exactly as we need it. And while we're waiting for the glue to dry, this is the perfect time to lap the back of the plane iron and sharpen the bevel. Now, one thing you might want to do before the glue is completely cured is you want to reach into the opening and peel the partially cured glue from the ramps. A sharp quarter-inch chisel is a great tool to do this. Just be careful not to gouge the side walls of the ramps. Now, if necessary, you may need to remove one of the clamps so you can get access to the throat. Luckily for me, I was able to get in without having to remove anything. With the glue up completely dry, it's time to start the final process of the assembly. First, I need to remove the exposed portions of the dowels. This, of course, is quickly done with my flush trimming saw. The next thing I want to do is I want to flatten both sides of the body. Now, this is where having a granite top table saw comes in handy. I simply lay down a sheet of 220 sandpaper and I go to town. Well, obviously this is sped up considerably because there's no way in the world I could handle this type of pace. But I could have used a coarser grit, which would have helped to speed up the process, but I wanted to have a lot more control over the amount of material that I'm removing. It's very crucial to have both sides parallel with each other and square to the bottom. So unlike other lapping incidents which happen to have occurred with hand planes, I make sure to lock my arm and distribute even pressure during the entire process to both sides and check periodically to make sure that it's flat. Once I'm certain the sides are flat and parallel, it's time to tweak the sole. Now essentially it's the same process, granite top table saw, 220 sandpaper, and a whole lot of concentration. After a few passes, I check the progress with a square and will repeat the whole thing until I'm satisfied it's perfectly parallel side to side and square with the sole. The next step is to adjust the mouth of the plane. Now, if you remember, we positioned the block so the blade is slightly enclosed and needs to be tipped to get in and out. It's now time to tweak the opening by removing small amounts of material until the blade can just protrude through the opening. This is basically creating a zero clearance opening at the mouth, and the end result of this step will help to ensure the kind of shavings that we ideally want from a shoulder plane, nice and thin. Make sure you take your time with this, as the end result of your patience can pay off quite nicely when you use it for the very first time. With the mouth adjusted and the blade in place, it's time to insert the wedge. Now, if you haven't used wooden hand planes before, it'll take some practice, but you know, you'll be setting the wedge and adjusting it in no time at all. Now, one great feature of the Hock Shoulder Plane kit is that once it's built, you can shape and adjust it to fit your style of work, or more specifically, you. I played around with a few design ideas and I quickly caught myself shaping it before I could turn on the camera. So here's a little bit of what I did to give you an idea of how you can go about customizing it for yourself. When it comes to cutting the shape, you don't have to use just hand tools for the process. You could easily, say, use a bandsaw or maybe even a jigsaw. But, you know, I thought it would be fun to try it out. Now, once I laid out my lines using a French curve, I grabbed my coping saw to start removing the waste. I wish I had taken the time to maybe replace the blade before I did this, as I quickly discovered the hardwoods of the kit were starting to fight back and resisting being shaped. In fact, you may notice as I'm cutting, I'm not quite doing a good job of staying within my lines, but this is no big deal. All that matters to me is that I have a plane that feels good in my hands and works easily as a result. And once I have this rough shape cut out, we're going to go ahead and refine it with some other hand tools, specifically spoke shaves. Now, the overall goal of this shape was to have something in the back that I could easily grasp and also push with the palm of my hand. And at the front, I wanted a flat for my thumb so that I could push down while the rest of my hand kind of curls under and pushes it tight against the material. It looks like we achieved that, so now it's time to refine it. And to do this task, I'm going to turn to my spoke shaves. More specifically, I'm going to use my Veritas low angle spoke shave. Now, because of the shape of the plane, I'm dealing with more exposed end grains, and the low angle shave can handle it very easily. The goal here isn't to make a perfectly flat surface, but instead, I want to soften and round over the edges. I have a feeling this plane will be seeing its fair share of abuse, and having the edges rounded over will help to ensure there's little to no chance of splintering. Now, in this situation, I'm using my square more or less kind of as an eyeball gauge to see if I need to take a little bit off of one side or the other so I have a balanced feel to it. And this again leads to the whole idea of by having that balanced feel, it's going to feel nice in the hands, and that's probably one of the most important things. In fact, it's those small imperfections of the surface that are left behind that gives it a worn, used feeling like no other tool I own. One last thing to do before I set the blade and take her for a test ride is to level out the flat on top. Again, simply to ensure a comfortable feel. But once that's done, I cut the wedge to length, center the blade in the mouth, then I'll adjust for the depth of cut, and I'm going to take her for a maiden voyage. Beautiful. Look at those shavings. And that happens to be maple end grain also.
So I hope you enjoyed today's build. Like I said, building the Hock Shoulder Plane Kit is a great way to build your own hand plane where you can customize it, especially being able to build a specialized hand plane like this. There won't be any other like it out there, especially this one right here. I don't think anybody would want to build this one again. Like I said, it works for me, and that's probably the most important thing. Now, for the second half of the show, I just want to touch on the fact that there are a lot of other kits out there, other do-it-yourself toolkits, and it's not just hand planes. As I mentioned with the Hock kits, there's the shoulder plane, and then there's the Krenov style smoother that you can get, which is another hand plane that I think we're going to want to build here on the show. There are great books out there about how to build your own hand planes. In fact, I'll try to make sure I have links in the show notes so that you can get take a look at the copies of them, maybe order one for yourself. I have one around here someplace that I've got some stock sitting over there, and our good friends over at Bell Forest could probably help us out also with getting some great material for it so we could build our own. Another one, you're probably obviously familiar with this guy from earlier. This is a Ron Breese plane, and this one is much more expensive than the other one, like the Hock plane kit. But the neat thing about this is, again, you're getting a really beautiful infill, and this is a whole other level, but again, extremely fun when it comes down to it, because in the end, you can easily hold something up like this and say, hey, I built that. Now, some other tool makers that I want to mention, of course, Veritas actually has a couple of kits. One of them is for their low angle spoke shave. It comes with everything that you need for it except for the wood. So that's a really neat one because low angle spoke shaves work fantastic. Of course, they're the ones that maybe you're more the traditional spoke shaves that you're probably familiar with work great too, but having one that, again, is customized to your hands, to the way that you work, working with a really beautiful piece of wood for that particular tool, it says a lot about the craftsman that's using it. And, well, let's get serious, it's a lot of fun. It's something that you wouldn't mind handing down to other family members. Of course, let's see, Wentzloff and Sons, they have a saw kit where you get everything that you need for it. It's the blade, it's the depending on if it's a back saw, which I think is there's one on that. You're gonna have to excuse me, I didn't look that one up real quick before I came on. The only thing that you need to provide is the wood itself, and again, this is a chance to show off maybe a really beautiful piece of stock that you have laying around, or one that you happen to stumble across. The beauty of using kits like this with the material that you find yourself is sometimes you just have a small piece, you don't know what to do with it, you don't want to waste it. This is the perfect opportunity to incorporate that into something that you're absolutely going to cherish. Now, another thing you could easily do, and this doesn't really fall into the realm of kits, is you could use that material to maybe replace an existing handle or something that you're not too fond of. Quite a few people will talk about replacing handles on, say, turning tools or with chisels, or again, maybe an existing handsaw that you have that you're not too crazy about the way it fits or the way it feels or just the way it looks. It's a really neat opportunity to do it. One more tool maker that I want to mention who definitely has quite a few kits in his lineup is Bob over at Check Edge Tools. Now, this happens to be, oh man, he's going to kill me for this one. I believe this is his Pilot marking knife. I love this. This is my go-to one right now. And this is a beautiful Coca-Cola that he used. In fact, oh man, I got a little dent in there. But you can get a full kit, again, it doesn't have the wood itself. It has everything that you would need to attach to the wood to get the type of marking tool, or he also has scratch awls. He has burnishers. Let's see, what else does he have? I think those are the main ones he has. Head on over to Check Edge Tool and you can check it out there. See all the different kits that he has. So again, you can build a tool that is specialized just for you. Of course, I'll have instructions on how to get the look that you see here in that particular kit, but if you're industrious enough, you could just get the blade itself and the ferrule and all that stuff and come up with your very own that works even better for you. Again, you'll find plans all over the place for, say, mallets. I don't know, you name it, you can probably find a kit out there for it. It is definitely a lot of fun, and this, again, is a neat way to get in the shop in between really big projects, or maybe this is the type of thing that you really enjoy doing, and you could potentially turn it into a moneymaker by making these kits or making something very similar to it and then selling them to your friends or giving away as gifts. Everybody loves to get a nice handmade gift, and this is probably one that you know for a fact that your fellow woodworker would absolutely love. So, once again, thanks for stopping by and checking out the shoulder plane kit here from Ron Hock. Again, I'll have links in all the show notes for all these different manufacturers. If I come across a few more that I totally forgot to mention in here who have kits, ones that I know you would really enjoy using, I'll make sure to put those in there. Or even better yet, you can put those in the comments section. And of course, you can always drop me a line if you have comments, questions, or suggestions. And that's, of course, at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Or just simply stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com, where you can check out all the previous shows we have, or definitely come back and check this one out over and over and over again, which I would really love. So anyways, though, until the next time, I'll be talking to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. I need to go find something to use this baby on.
To find the show notes and links mentioned in today's episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. There you'll find information on how to subscribe to the show, enter our monthly swag drawings, and more. And while you're there, please consider helping to support the show by visiting our various advertisers and sponsors. By clicking on the links and making purchases, you not only have a chance to buy great tools and services for yourself, but you also have a chance to help support the show.